Our first chat this morning is with a man tasked to steer the development goals of the Philippines for both short and long term. He describes himself as an economist, diving into development policy making, administration, antitrust, scholarly research, and teaching. Second time NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisaca now joins us live. Secretary, welcome back to Market Edge. Hi.
Hi. Good morning, Mimi.
Good morning, sir. So I want to begin, Secretary, I want to begin with your tweet from your China trip with the president last week, where you said, what is most encouraging, perhaps, the biggest, this is what you said. It's very encouraging to hear many of China's captains and leaders of agribusiness, energy, and manufacturing sharing their plans to invest or to expand their Philippine operations at the three roundtables with the president during his state visit to Beijing. Mr. Secretary, may know what to you is the most encouraging, perhaps the biggest or most ambitious plan you've heard from the roundtables?
I think what we heard from the Chinese businessman, and we are talking about Chinese businessman here, not the governments.
All right.
Is that their interest to invest substantial resources in the Philippines? We are talking about $22.8 billion in investment in various areas, particularly in agribusiness, energy, and strategic manufacturing, particularly e-vehicles and mineral processing. So what we will need to do, as I pointed out earlier, is to facilitate that our processes or these investments so that they come in quickly and get our year, 2020, this current year, starting with the right foot.
Mm-hmm. Sir, but what do you think is the most achievable at the soonest possible time? Is there any proposed deal or expansion or a company plan that stands out?
Many of these, or some of these, are already in early stages of implementation, actually. Mm-hmm. Some are already in the process of registration. Some have started early implementation with their domestic partners in the Philippines. Some are obviously also in the making, but I think the electric vehicles, for example, mineral processing, these are very strategic areas. As we pointed out earlier, we're moving into a more strategic areas of manufacturing and sectors of the economy, and we do believe that if we can position ourselves into this new economy, digitalization, e-commerce, e-vehicles, and use our mineral resources strategically, such as exporting, processing, or our mineral ores. I think this will create a lot of opportunities for us, particularly quality jobs.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. All right, we'll talk about quality jobs later, sir. And it's great that you made a distinction at the start of the conversation that these things that you talked about are from the private businessmen, the private Chinese businessmen. What about on the government side? Because when Filipinos hear that there are dealings between whether it's Chinese business to business or Chinese government to the Philippine government, there's always a sense of distrust. Because China doesn't exactly, have a stellar record of delivering on these promises. I want to go back to the last couple of years. The government, Chinese government, actually in 2021, out of 14 China-funded infrastructure projects in the pipeline, only one was completed in 2021. That was the Binondo-Intramuros Bridge. Only three others were under construction. The rest didn't even break ground, haven't even been approved yet. So are you confident that all of these talks that you heard from the private sector and maybe from the government side, that they can actually be implemented and carried out and executed?
This is part of the exercise, in this visit to reconfirm what their intentions are. And from what we heard, there's quite a strong interest in re-engaging with the Philippines, particularly in the area of investment. So, and we are following this up. We are sending the signals, of course, that if they don't move early on, we are also open to opening these areas that they earlier on committed to other players in the international community. So we can't obviously wait forever for the investment to come in. So it's a signal that and both sides are saying that we are interested to be engaged. And so I think I'm quite optimistic that this time things will be faster, will
move
faster.
All right. And I do believe that you're going to be on that case, sir. Finally, from the Philippine side now, the president's business delegation was supposed to have 85 industry leaders joining that Beijing trip, but only around 40 showed up. How substantial were the talks that you heard from the business side, from the Philippine side?
I think it's not, from the, my point of view, it's not so much the number, but so much the quality and outcomes that you have gained from that visit. As I said, roughly $23 billion of commitments, that's quite a huge amount of investments. And if they, if all this come in, that will a huge return for that visit. So I think that, again, we need to make sure that from our end, we also facilitate the business climate. We make the business climate favorable, and we get to facilitate the entry of these investors in the economy.
All right. And talking about making the business environment welcoming to all of these new investments. Let's talk about the business environment, sir. There's growing consensus. I want to start with inflation because we're coming from the inflation data last week. There's growing consensus, Mr. Secretary, that December's 8.1% could be the peak already. Do you think so? I mean, and even, if we get January's print and it shows the number is starting to go down, one number barely makes a trend. So what makes you think, if you do believe, that this could be the peak already?
I think that we have learned quite a deal last year in dealing with inflation. For example, we do know that this combination of external headwinds, like the Ukraine war, the disruption of the value chain, the global trade, and the domestic shocks that we had, typhoons and animal diseases. Now, some of these are within our control, and we could have done better, I would say. For example, when we knew that there were shortages already because of these typhoons and continuing animal diseases, we could have facilitated and more aggressive in developing that or bringing in those imports. And that's what we would want to achieve this time, that well ahead of time, we would know exactly what the market outlook look like, the supply and demand situation for each of these essential commodities, so that we can program the timely importation of particularly essential commodities like food. We don't know very well that the basic sources of this inflation were from food and energy, fuel in particular. I think that given that the first quarter of the year is usually the harvest season, the planting season for vegetables, for example, and we don't expect any major climate natural disruptions during this period. I think the market should recover, and I would expect that inflation would start to fall in the coming months. And for the entire year, we are expecting inflation to range from 2.5 to 4.5%. So I think That should be good for consumption and for the economy as a whole.
So, sir, do you think that because of this outlook that you feel inflation will ease in the coming months, do you think the BSP will have less pressure on it to tighten, less pressure to step on the brakes at the risk of choking growth?
Yeah, well, yes, of course. Once they see that the inflation is under control, they should, I believe that they would act accordingly. And of course, our inflation is just one factor. The other factor is what the rest of the world, particularly the U.S., will do. No? And for so long as the U.S. will continue to tighten their monetary policy, then interest rates there would increase, and we may act accordingly to ensure that we don't have the negative external effects of those movements elsewhere. But I think the bigger source of this uptick in the interest rates is the high inflation that we have seen in recent months. And so with the inflation pressure diminishing in the coming months, I think that will be less pressure for BSP to increase their policy rates.
All right, but here's the thing, sir. When you look at the big picture, we're all bracing for a recession, a slowdown. Not a recession for the Philippines like in the U.S. or Europe, but a slowdown in growth here in the Philippines. Still growing, but much slower. How much slower and how long do you think will this slowdown drag for the Philippines?
We are projecting 6 to 7% for the entire year. Many observers see that as too ambitious, but I don't think it's undoable. recall that mid next year, especially after the Ukraine war, many observers are quite pessimistic that we would even reach 6% or even 7%. No, but now obviously the results are for the entire year are likely to exceed 7%. So. There are surprises. I mean, if we have to manage the constraints to growth well, we have to address quickly issues, particularly inflation. I think that we can send those signals that inspire confidence in the economy and stakeholders, particularly consumers and businesses. We should be able to grow at a respectable rate despite the turbulence elsewhere, in particularly the recession in major economies of the world.
If there's anything we know about you, Mr. Secretary, is that you're not just into numbers, you're into development issues. That what you really care about is not that we hit certain numbers or targets, but that people have better lives. I've personally covered you when I was a reporter, and that's what I noticed with you. So I guess my question now is, do you think that with this respectable growth expected this year, people, the ordinary Filipino, will have an easier time, you know, steering their lives for 2023? Because we're all coming from a pandemic. People have much shorter runways today. They've either dipped into or touched or used up their savings already in the last 3 years. So any slowdown, I imagine, will be magnified more sharply this time around, you think? Or is there a way around it?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question, Amy. Of course, growth is not the end of thing. You know, it's not the end goal here. It's really the improvement in the welfare of our people. So what we have outlined in our Philippine Development Plan is a growth that is inclusive, that's going to be beneficial for all Filipinos. And what that means is that growth must be accompanied by generation of better and higher quality jobs, not just more jobs, but more importantly, better and higher quality jobs. And also inflation must be under control, because inflation hurt, particularly if this inflation is coming from food and essential commodities, inflation will hurt the poorest sectors of our society most. The growth has to be, again, inclusive, has to be associated with improvement in the quality of jobs, not just in more jobs, but in higher quality jobs. That has to be associated with the low inflation, and that way we can raise everybody's welfare. And then in the medium term, as we elaborated in our upcoming Philippine Development Plan that was just launched at the closing end of last year, growth growth of 6.5 to 8% for 2024 to 2028 will be accompanied by lower poverty, poverty reaching a single digit level by the end of 2028. And that, of course, assumes that we are able to create these high quality jobs that I am talking about, and that we are able to manage our macroeconomic environment such that inflation is under control, that expectations of people with respect to the macroeconomy are favorable, that the deficits are not going to threaten or elevate risk, and so on and so forth. And we are quite confident that with the economic team and all the members of the cabinet working together, and it's what we are emphasizing in the plan, that the government must be seen as an agent of change, working together, all these agencies and branches of government working together toward a common goal, and that is the goals elaborated in the plan.
But sir, if I may just, because in the short term, in the now, in the today and in the now, how people feel about the quality of their lives is they know they can't afford onions. They also know that they cannot make travel plans without, putting in the possibility that the airport system might break down and that they might have to wait 2-3 days before they can fly out or fly in. These are some of the more concrete examples of how Filipinos can feel development in their lives or the lack thereof.
Yeah, precisely, and that's why we need to address those short-term issues. We're quite clear in the plan what those short-term issues are, particularly those issues associated with the consequences of the COVID-19. The COVID-19, the pandemic has created so much scars in our social economic fabric, and it behooves on us to ensure that we recover from that quickly. And inflation is a major issue that we need to address quickly. And I believe that what we are putting in place will address that the inflation. And as I said, this year we expect a major improvement in the situation. But in the medium term, what we really need is to address what we refer to as constraints to growth and poverty reduction, and we're talking about long-term issues and the backlogs in our connectivity and basic infrastructure like roads, bridges, power, telecommunication.
Which, Mr. Secretary, leads me to my next question and our final question. I know that you are with the ICC Investment Committee. You with the president and other heads of economic managers. Are there any other big pending projects in the pipeline that's up for approval that makes you very excited?
Oh, there are many now, especially that we have already amended the guidelines and processes for the public-private partnership. Mm-hmm. You may know, we are elevating the importance of PPPs in our program, partly because of the fiscal limited fiscal space arising from our responses to the pandemic. So we are trying to improve the investment climate here, mm-hmm. Particularly and how investors see the integrity of mm-hmm. of contracts like what we have in the PPPs.
Any contract, sir, that makes you very excited today?
Well, we have a number that are in place right now that are under the various stages of. Mm. Of developments from railways, as we have heard from the president, we are prioritizing and mass transit, particularly mm-hmm. railways. We are prioritizing and improving connectivity of our various islands. We are developing, for example, we hope to complete that Cavite to Bataan bridge that will be supported by the Asian Development Bank, and that can be moved into a PPP for its maintenance and operations, for example. There are many that we are working on, including hospitals and specialty hospitals like PGH, for example. There's a PPP proposal that is under consideration now to establish more access to hospitals, PGH in Diliman, for example. That would improve access to health facilities among.
All right, Mr. Secretary, thank you so much for the time, for sharing your insights and the exciting plans ahead. We look forward to more discourses like this as we go along through the year. It's going to be an exciting year. Hopefully, the Philippines still a bright star in this dark, gloomy environment. Thank you, sir, for the time.
Thank you so much, Mimi.
All right.
All right. Bye bye.